Hello everybody, in today's lecture we'll be talking about the animal house guidelines, where we'll discuss on what to do and what not to do in maintenance of an animal house and in carrying out animal experiments. Good laboratory practices are essential for animal facilities. This is to assure that there is a quality maintenance and safety of animals while using them for laboratory studies. And generally these laboratory studies mostly pertain to biomedical and behavioral research and also testing of products. The goal of such guidelines is to promote the humane care of animals, which will enhance the animal well-being and also the quality in this particular pursuit of advancement of biological knowledge, which will be relevant to both the humans and animals. So the first concern that we'll come across in animal care or animal handling is veterinary care. So there has to be a veterinarian who takes care of the animal facility, and it will be entirely his responsibility to provide adequate care. Furthermore, there can be daily observation of animals, which can be accomplished by somebody other than veterinarian, just in case the veterinarian is not available or something. But this has to be carried out with direct and frequent communication about the animal health, behavior and well-being. So the person who is taking care of the animals and observing them and the veterinarian must be in direct communication regarding the animal health, behavior and well-being. Also, there must be appropriate policies and procedures which must be established by the veterinarian. So these will be the ancillary aspects of veterinary care, which will involve reviewing the protocols and proposals for standard operation of the animals. Also, the animal husbandry and animal welfare must be looked into. Additionally, the veterinarian holds the responsibility to monitor the occupational health hazards that may occur while handling animals. Furthermore, there should be a zoonosis control program and supervision of animal nutrition and sanitation. So all of these factors are very much important. Why? Because care must be taken to see that there is a common procedure that is followed throughout the animal lab, where the animals are used humanely for the purpose of research. And nextly, when we talk about animal husbandry, it is about their well-being and reproduction. And in the meantime, the personnel who are handling the animals must also be protected from the occupational health hazards. And zoonosis control programs are essential because they may lead to infection to the humans who are handling them. The next aspect with regard to animal management is animal procurement. The most importantly, all animals must be acquired lawfully according to the regulations put forth by the committee for the purpose of control and supervision on experiments on animals. That is commonly called the CPCSEA in India. So these CPCSEA guidelines are to be followed to procure the animals. And under these guidelines, there is requirement for a health surveillance program where the incoming animals are screened and assessed for quality. Another important parameter that is to be taken into consideration is on how the animal is transported to the facility. We'll talk about this in the next slide. Meanwhile, the next criteria is that the animal should be inspected, quarantined, and stabilized according to the procedures which are put forth by the OECD or the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. This organization is a global regulator for animal experiments. So they have guidelines for each and every type of procedure that is to be carried out on animals, and also on different types of animals, be it a fish or be it a mouse. There are guidelines put forth by the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development and are to be categorically followed for the animal experiment to be ethically approved. So now talking about the requirements for transport of laboratory animals, be it by road, rail or air. These requirements vary with the species that is being transported. So the most commonly used animals are mouse, rat, hamsters, guinea pig, rabbit, cat, dog and monkey, rodent to primates. And the maximum number of animals per cage will differ in each of these cases depending on the size of the animal. If it is a mouse, you can put about 25 animals per cage. Same is the number for rat and hamster. Meanwhile, you can only have about 12 guinea pigs in a cage, 2 rabbits, 1 or 2 cats, 1 or 2 dogs, or 1 monkey. So, talking about a cage, the space per animal and maximum height of the box also differs with the animal species. And actually, the material used for transport while preparing the cage or the box should either be metal, cardboard or synthetic material for mouse, rat, hamster, guinea pig or rabbit. Whereas for cat and dog, it is essentially metal to be used for transport box. Meanwhile, in the case of monkeys, bamboo, wood or metal can be used to transport the animal. Nextly, we have quarantine. Quarantine is separation of the newly received animals from those that are already available within the facility. This is to make sure that the health of the animals that are newly arrived is good, and also the microbial status of these animals is known. Quarantine is a word that is derived from Italian, and this is a practice that is commonly found nowadays. And the same thing applies for animals, where they are kept separately from the already available animals. And an effective quarantine will minimize the chances for the introduction of pathogens into an already established animal facility. And the duration of quarantine will differ with the animal again. For small lab animals, 1 week of quarantine is sufficient. Whereas for larger animals like that of the cat, dog or monkey, there has to be at least 6 weeks of quarantine to be followed. Personal hygiene of the animal handlers is also an important criteria to be kept in mind, where the animal care staff must maintain high standard of personal cleanliness and the animal facility should have facilities such as showers, change of uniform and footwears, etc. for the staff who are working there. Also, additionally, in places where such facilities may not be provided, use of disposable wear like gloves, masks, head covers, coats, coveralls and shoe covers can be encouraged. And most importantly, the animal handling staff must not be permitted to eat, drink, smoke or even apply cosmetics in the animal rooms. So, there should be a separate area provided for these purposes. In an event where the experimentation involves hazardous agents, the institutes where these experiments are being carried out should have certain governing policies. In order to take care of this governance, the institutes must have two different committees, where the first one will be the Institutional Biosafety Committee, which will take care of the containment levels or the containment procedures that are followed in the institute or in the facility that where the experiment is being carried out. And nextly, there has to be an Institutional Animal Ethics Committee, which will ensure that the animals are handled in the most humane way possible. Additionally, if there are procedures where multiple surgeries are to be done on a single animal, they have to be specified within the protocol and approved by the Institutional Animal Ethics Committee. Otherwise, this will not be allowed at any cost. Now, talking about euthanasia, when an animal is required to be sacrificed, there are certain protocols to be followed strictly to make this happen. Most importantly, euthanasia must be carried out quickly and painlessly in an atmosphere which does not cause fear or anxiety in the animal. Also, the animals must be exposed to certain initial depressive action on their central nervous system to provide an immediate insensitivity to the pain that may be caused due to the euthanasia process. However, the choice of how the animal is sacrificed will depend on the nature of the study and the species of the animal that is supposed to be killed. Notwithstanding, there are a few requirements that are to be followed for all the animals, where there has to be a death without causing anxiety, pain or distress, with a minimum time lag phase. Also, care must be taken to cause minimum physiological and psychological disturbances to the animal. Additionally, there must be care taken for checking of the compatibility with the purpose of the study, and also how minimally this sacrificing process can have an emotional effect on the operator or person carrying out the sacrifice. The animals must be sacrificed in a location that is separate from the animal rooms and which is free from environmental contaminants. In the case of larger species such as monkeys, dogs and cats, before the euthanasia procedure, tranquilizers must be administered to them before they are sacrificed. So now getting into the details which are specified in the guidelines regarding the euthanasia of laboratory animals, these methods vary with the species. So again, we have the mouse, rat, hamster, guinea pig, rabbit, cat, dog and monkey. There are three different methods that can be followed. First are the physical methods. Then we have inhalation of gases. And finally, drug administration. Under physical methods, there is electrocution, which is not recommended in any case, whereas exsanguination can be carried out for mouse, rat, hamster, guinea pig, rabbit and cat, but they are not recommended for dog and monkey. Nextly, there is decapitation, where this procedure can be carried out only on the mouse and rat. And cervical dislocation, the last physical method here, can be performed on mouse, rat and hamster only. While it is not recommended for guinea pig, rabbit, cat, dog or monkey. Nextly, in the case of inhalation of gases, there can be use of carbon monoxide, which can be performed on all the species here, whereas carbon dioxide inhalation is applicable only to mouse, rat, hamster, guinea pig, rabbit and cat, but not dog or monkeys. Same is the case with carbon dioxide plus chloroform or halothane. Whereas chloroform or halothane can be independently given to all the species again. Next, talking about drug administration, there can be various overdoses that can be performed, and there are specific routes of administration of these drugs as well. So there is barbiturate overdose, which is administered intraperitoneally in all the animals, and it is acceptable. It can also be administered intravenously in the case of rabbit, cat, dog and monkey. Nextly, we have the chloral hydrate overdose, which is carried out intravenously only in rabbit, cat, dog and monkey. Further, there is ketamine overdose, which can be performed on all the animals either through the intravenous or the intramuscular route for larger animals like the rabbit, cat, dog and monkey, or through the intramuscular and intraperitoneal route for smaller species like mouse, rat, hamster and guinea pig. And lastly, we have the sodium pentothal overdose, which can be performed on all the animals while it is administered intraperitoneally for the smaller animals like mouse, rat, hamster and guinea pig. It has to be administered intravenously for rabbit, cat, dog and monkey. Apart from these, there are a few methods that are not acceptable for any species of the animals. While the physical methods include decompression and stunning, the inhalation of gases like nitrogen and argon by the methods of flushing is not acceptable. And lastly, euthanasia of the animals using administration of drugs such as cuciform, nicotine sulfate, magnesium sulfate, potassium chloride, strychnine, paraquat, dichlorvas or air embolism is totally not recommended in any case. So these are the guidelines that are to be strictly followed in animal labs to meet the animal ethical requirements and to perform acceptable animal experiments. So with this, I would like to conclude today's lecture. Thank you all.